Have any of you never flown in a plane before, like a commercial plane? Basically, you are on the verge of death, like non-stop. Because that plane would, no, I'm making it up. No, but when we took out of Denver, so my family and I, we live in Southern Colorado, down the coast of New Mexico, and so we had to drive for like 3 hours to get to Denver, and then that's when I get on a plane that only takes like an hour and 10 minutes to get here. So it takes us longer to drive through the mountains to get to the airport than it did to fly here. And so we flew out of Denver, and for those of you that have flown before, you know, sometimes the plane's like a little bumpy, and you're like grooving, you know? You're like, oh yeah, that's right. Well, but it wasn't like this, it was like, it's like twerking or something. It's weird. So for about 20 to 25 minutes, there were people giving their lives to Jesus. It was really awesome. Hey, I know Jake just prayed, but I'd totally love to pray with you guys also. And I'm honestly, whenever I speak, I freak out. So I just want to pray that Jesus uses this time, all right? God, thank you again for this time, and thank you for the opportunity that we have to worship you through song and worship you through raking leaves and through doing all sorts of work. God, our lives are about worshiping you. We're worshiping you, we're worshiping ourselves, or somebody else, or something else. And Lord, I just ask that this weekend that we will be drawn closer to you. Father, whenever I'm speaking, just move me out of the way. You know I'm selfish. You know I want it to be about me. Just move me out of the way and use my voice and speak to all of us. God, I need to hear from you. I really need to hear from you. Lord, your faithfulness goes on in ways that I don't even understand. Why you would have patience with me? It's just your love, God. It's your love. Thank you most of all for Jesus. He's... Thanks for praying in his name. Amen. All right. Does everybody have one of these? Mine's black and white because I'm old school. But everybody got one of these and a pen? So probably down here towards the bottom there's a line and you can put your name on there. Make sure to write your name on that. So if you happen to set your little pamphlet thing down, then somebody's going to be able to find it and they know it's not yours. And you know, you'll be able to find it. Because you might write something in here. You might learn something this weekend, believe it or not, that you actually like. And you come away saying, hey, I need to remember that. I need to write that thing down. I may say something that's not in the notes. Turn with me like to the page 2, I guess, and it shows like the schedule there. You know what I'm talking about? That just kind of gives you, you know, it's a schedule, and it involves clocks and stuff. So if you're using a sundial, good luck. Then the next page, it shows you your quiet time. And guys, I want you to pay attention on this. Because tomorrow morning, you're going to wake up, and you're going to have some time for quiet time. And I want to make sure that you're doing that. This is a time for you to reflect. It's just you and God. This should not be you and somebody else, like your boyfriend. It shouldn't be him or your girlfriend. It's just you and God. And just being honest with him. So that's your, you'll see there's a Sunday morning quiet time. Some stuff to read there. And look, here's the deal. There's no shame in this. I want you guys to understand this, all right? If this whole thing is new to you and you don't understand Jesus and you don't understand the Bible, that's totally cool. That's totally cool. Grab an adult and say, hey, can you help me? I'm not even sure where these things are. Where's it? Philip, I don't even know who that is. What is that? And just grab an adult and say, can you help me? And I promise you, the adults, me, Reg, any of us, would love to just sit down with you and go through this stuff with you, okay? So there's no shame in that. And then you see there's a Sunday morning quiet time. You turn to the next page, it talks about, think about these scriptures this weekend. Some of you are just going to, like, look at that title and then just move on. Because you're not interested in what the Word of God says. That's between you and Him. But I would challenge you to consider that this is not, you know, this is like ants on a page type stuff. But the words that are communicated to us through the Word of God is just that. It's the Word of God. Okay? So take it to heart. Think about it. If you aren't really sure what to do with that, pray. You say, God, I'm about to read John 1:1-3. Help me to understand what that's meaning. Because sometimes, Lord, I get a little dense, you know? A couple head injuries, a couple concussions, snowboarding went bad. And so, Lord, I just pray that you help me with that. You've never read that verse too many times. You need to understand that, guys. You'll never read the Bible. You'll never read John 3:16 too many times. Because the Holy Spirit will continue to transform you by the renewing of your mind. And then you can notice the next page, it's how a servant thinks, how a servant acts. You guys got that page? reflect on that. Think about what that means. So, with that, we're going to go on to session el numero uno, or session hashtag uno, for those of you that are Instagrammers. He must increase and I must decrease. That's the title of it. You got to give titles. See, whenever you do like speaking stuff, you have to give titles. I don't know why. It doesn't make any sense to me. But let me read you a real life account of something that happened in the war. A young military woman lost her left arm when she and other troops were on top of a roof in a hostile area. A rocket-propelled grenade came in and exploded on the rooftop, severing her arm and badly injuring others. She was rushed from the area to get medical treatment. When she became aware of what had actually happened, when the shock was wearing out, she cried out, "My hand! My hand!" She explained the problem wasn't her missing arm, it was her hand, because on her hand was her wedding ring. And now her ring's gone. And so the troops that were with her, they go against higher-ranking military orders, and they go back into that region, they go back to that rooftop against orders, through danger, through firefighting, they find her hand with the ring, they grab it, they rush from the scene, they get back to her to get her the ring. Why? It mattered to her. They were willing to risk their lives. They were willing to risk everything that they have, their own limbs. They're willing to give this stuff up because her wedding band mattered to her. They were willing to lay down everything for her, for something that was just important to her. We're not even talking about eternity, guys. And they were willing to give that up. They were willing to put that on the line for her. Look at the first quote there. It says, "Radical selflessness will always bring us the greatest joy and the truest purpose." Radical selflessness will always bring us the greatest joy and the truest purpose. Let me do something with you. So last night I was hanging out at Reg's house. So Reg, Jamie, and you know the three amigos that live with them. And you know, if you've heard Ryan, he's like talking about like, "What in tarnation?" You guys know what that is? Anyone know? Yeah. Okay, so we're working on this last night. Audrey, she was just like scribbling. She was like doing the hieroglyphics on the paper and the pen. And you know, that's like, you got it. Anyway. So here's the deal. Here's what we're going to do. We're going to say, "What in the name of foundation is going on?" Okay? Yeah, you guys got it? So we got to yell it out together. "What in the name of foundation is going on?" You guys got it? Okay, ready? 1, 2, 3.
What in the name of foundation is going on?
All right, now that was good, but now you got to get that twang in there. You know what I'm talking about? Because you can't say it like you're from New York. You know what I'm talking about? What in the name of foundation is going on? You can't say it like that. And then you can't talk like a valley girl. What name foundation? No, you gotta put some twang into it. Alright, so we gotta do it again. Because I got a lot of friends from the South, and they speak with the twang, and it's all good. Because I love them, and Jesus loves them, and they speak better than I do. So, we're gonna do it again, but now we're gonna do it with the twang, okay? So, what in the name of foundation is going on? But with the twang. You ready? 1, 2, 3.
What in the name of foundation is going on?
Man. Oh, that's good. Look at John chapter 3. If you're not sure where that is, just turn to your partner or rather adult, whatever you got to do, and say, "Hey, I'm not really sure where John chapter 3 is." You know, like John 3:16, but we're looking at John chapter 3, verse 30. Yo. You guys got John chapter 3? All right, so I need everybody to listen up, because this is the key text for tonight. This is like the main focus point for what we're going to talk about tonight.
I'm glad you're here.
Now, I want you to understand something. This is John the Baptist who is speaking. This is not John the disciple. You guys understand that? There's two different Johns. And we're talking about John the Baptist here. He is the forerunner of Christ. He's the crazy, wacky dude who lived out in the sticks and he wore like camel skins and he ate bugs and honey. Now, if you take a bug and dip it in honey or chocolate, that's okay, but I don't know if he was dipping. So, anyway, let's look at this together here. John chapter 3, verses 30 through 36. Yeah. John starts off with this. He must become greater, and I must become less. Or maybe your text will read, he must increase, and I must decrease. The one who comes from above is above all. The one who is from the earth belongs to the earth and speaks as one from the earth. The one who comes from heaven is above all. Remember that. He testifies to what he has seen and heard, but no one accepts his testimony. The man who has accepted it is certified, has certified that God is truthful. For the one whom God has sent speaks the words of God, for God gives the Spirit without limit. The Father loves the Son and has placed everything in his hands. Whoever believes in the Son has eternal life, but whoever rejects the Son will not see life, for God's wrath remains on him. Now, flip over to Colossians. So if you're in John, you're going to hang a right turn. Go through Acts, Romans, 1st and 2nd Corinthians, Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians. If you're not sure, grab your friend. And now we're going to look at, you got the text there, Colossians 1, 15 to 19. Paul's talking about the supremacy of Christ. You guys got this? Colossians chapter 1, verses 15 to 19. Check this out. So this is what Paul writes. He's talking now about Jesus. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For by him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities. All things were created by him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together. And he is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning and the firstborn from among the dead, so that in everything he might have the supremacy. Now, we're not doing like a whole lot of fill in the blank this weekend, okay? I talked to Greg about it. We're not like going to be doing the slides and stuff. I just want you guys to like talk this weekend. So here's this question. If you want to write on here, here's the thing. If you want to jot notes, stuff like that, questions, if something pops in your head, you're like, that doesn't make any sense, man. Write it down. Please, write your questions down and ask. My friend Jerry, he is always asking me questions. I'll tell you guys about Jerry a little bit. But here's the question. So does Jesus need to increase or become greater? Remember our first text. It says he must increase or he must become greater and I must decrease. Let me ask you a question. Does Jesus actually need to increase? What do you think? How many of you think yes? How many of you think no? How many of you don't know? It's okay. That's okay. If you don't know, there's no shame, okay? I want you to think about this. John the Baptist said Jesus, he must increase. He must become greater. What does he mean? Why did John say that? Anyone have any ideas? Why does he say that Jesus, Leo, what do you think?
I think what he's saying is we need to give more to God and to others and stop thinking about how can I get more for myself.
Okay, so what Leo was saying then is let me make sure I'm understanding this. It's not necessarily about Jesus increasing, it's about me. Is that what you're saying? It's about you, it's about us. You guess?
Yeah.
I don't want to mix up your words.
Less about ourselves and more about
him. Less about me and more about him. Did you guys catch that? Leo was saying that it is less about me, less about you, less about us, and more about him. Do you guys agree with that?
Yeah.
Or is that just a bunch of jive?
Amen.
Amen. It's my Baptist brother right here.
I want to go with that.
That's cool, man. That's good. That's good. He must increase. And so I put, does Jesus need to increase or become greater? No. Think about that passage in Colossians. He's the supremacy. Paul says this, everything was created by, through, and for the person of Jesus Christ. Now, I don't think, you know, I got to give you an illustration from the mountains because that's where I live. I live in the mountains. I live in a valley. It's called the Wet Mountain Valley, and the valley is actually at 8,000 feet in elevation, so we are a mile and a half above sea level. Our local high school, their football stadium, you know, like Denver, it used to be called the Mile High Stadium, or what, maybe it still is, I don't know. I don't follow the Broncos, but so they at our football stadium, they call it the Mile and a Half Stadium. It's kind of funny. Anyway, so we live in this beautiful valley, and then just to the west is this mountain range called the Sangre de Cristos, and they are some of the most rugged mountains in the state of Colorado. They just like shoot straight from 9,000 feet just straight up to 13 and 14,000 foot mountains. And they're just treacherous and the rocks and all kinds of stuff. And when you look at those, when you're up into them, when you're up climbing around in them and stuff, you're like, oh my word, you feel really small. Really small and really vulnerable because that these mountains, the magnificence of them is just huge. You're just like, oh wow. And then when you go back to the creation account, when God creates everything, he doesn't even use his hands. I can imagine, you know, God is just like, hey, check this out. I'm going to do all this with my hands in my pockets. And so he speaks everything into creation. Jesus was part of creation. He is part of the speaking, the verbalizing to create mountains. The Himalayas and the Karakoram Range where mountaineers climb and they die, and it's just crazy stuff. And Jesus, you know, he speaks the oceans into existence, and the air and the universe, and he speaks everything into existence. And let me tell you what I have spoken in my life. I have spoken destruction. I have spoken wrath. I have spoken stuff that has cut people down. What kind of credit do I get? Nothing. The things that come out of my mouth is an indication of the wickedness of my heart. I can't create nothing. None of it. Only Jesus has done that. And so when Paul is talking about how Jesus is the firstborn, he's the supremacy over everything. It's all about him. And John is saying, he must increase and I must decrease. Well, Jesus can't increase anymore. For our perspective here today, 2017, Jesus cannot increase anymore. He's it. He's the highest. But like Leo said, and John said this, I must decrease. What the name of foundation is going on, this has got to be your foundation. He must increase and I must decrease. If you're going to be a servant like Christ himself, you hinge on the concept of him being greater by you glorifying him. That's you here, right here. That's you on your knees saying, it's you, it's not me. Jesus, it's you, it's not me. Your friends are looking at you, they're saying, man, dude, you're on your knees, you look goofy. And they're making jokes about you, and it's just horrible stuff. And you're saying, that's fine, it's not about me. It's not about you either, it's about Jesus. Oh, no, we can't do that, right? We can't get on our knees because we don't want anyone to laugh at us. Why? Because the fact is, I think one of the things we all struggle with is I must increase. That's what I want. I want you all to think about me. I want you to remember my name. Oh, Steve Reiff from Colorado, blah, 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 and Mountaineer and Raft Guy and all this stuff. Who cares about me? I didn't die for anybody. I wouldn't even die for a good man. Jesus died for the worst. He died for each one of us. He alone is the one who deserves to be worshipped. He alone is the one. And so here's the thing. We don't understand perfection. Perfection is not even in our mindset. It's something we don't even rationalize. We can't comprehend perfection. Perfection only happened once, and that was with Adam and Eve in the garden. like 75 billion years ago, or 14 years ago, or whatever, I don't care. It happened with them, and they understood perfection, and then sin happened, and they were the only human beings to know what perfection was. And then they knew that it was stripped away from them because of sin. And now the rest of us, we live in sin. And we are born in sin. And we are born enemies of God. You go back to the, if any of you know like old world history, you may know some about what your posture had to be before, when you come before the king of your country. When you would come before a king, your physical posture must be in such a way that the king is okay with it. And if he is not okay with it, he's going to have you put to death. Right? Any of you know that? I mean, your head's going on the chopping block. And so now we have the king of all creation, the king of all glory, Jesus. And we come before him, we're like, yo, Jesus, what's up, man? Right? And we're just acting like clowns when we come into his presence a lot of times, not with an attitude of worship. We come with an attitude of me. 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 I please increase me, Jesus. I want it to be about me. I want to make fortune and fame, and I want to write books and have people buy books, and it'd be great. I want people to know me. Me, 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 me. And John comes out of the wilderness looking like some kind of a mountain man all messed up. And he's saying, no, it's not about me. I'm not even worthy to untie his sandals. I can't even scrape the poo off of his sandals from walking around in the streets with all the animals. I'm not even worthy of doing that. He must increase and I must decrease. It's all about Jesus. Look at Mark chapter 7, verses 20 to 23. So now you're going to hang a left turn. Get back to John, go a little bit further left. Matthew, Mark. Maybe you're sitting there and you're saying, you know, Steve, I'm really not that bad of a person. I mean, I'm not that bad. Steve, obviously, I don't have tattoos like you, and I don't do this, and I don't do that. You know, we can do that stuff. We can justify ourselves, and we can try to justify ourselves. But these are the words of Christ when he's talking about the condition of our hearts. I want you to think about this as I'm reading this and you're reading it. Think about this. Is this true of you? He went on. What comes out of a man is what makes him unclean. For from within, out of men's hearts, come evil thoughts, sexual immorality, theft, murder, adultery, greed, malice, deceit, lewdness, envy, slander, arrogance, and folly. All these evils come from inside and make a man unclean. When you understand that, you understand the reason why we are decreasing, why we should increase. When you're in the presence of perfection of Jesus Christ, it's about him and it's not about me. You guys understand what I'm telling you? Or is this just like, let me know if this isn't making sense, because if this doesn't make sense, we got to make sure and get this as our foundation. We've got to understand this. Otherwise, this whole weekend is just a wash. It doesn't matter what you're serving here. It doesn't matter what you're raking. Because when it comes to eternity, if you are not saying Jesus is the one, he increases, I decrease, I am finding myself in his presence, it's all about him, it's not about me. If that is not your mentality, then you have no hope in eternity. You get that? If your life is not about Jesus Christ, you don't have a hope. It won't matter how many leaves you rake. You're not going to win brownie points with God. It doesn't happen. You can't do right things to make up for the wrong things that you've done. You can't do it. Do we need to decrease? You need to think about this. You think about it on your own time. You think about it tonight. I want you to think, have you been trying to make yourself greater? Trying to get those trophies. You know, in school, I remember in school, you know, they got the trophy case, right? Do they have a trophy case at your school? Are you trying to get trophies? Are you trying to get, you know what I'm talking about, though. Maybe it's not a trophy in that case. Maybe it's just some sort of accolades from your friends. Maybe it's some kind of respect from your parents. You want to live up to their standard or something like that. Maybe it's about getting high fives from, you know, somebody popular at school, or getting good grades with a certain teacher, and that's what you want more than anything else. Turn to the next page. Up top it says raft. If you look in small print, right there next to it, ing is fun. Rafting is fun. Little plug there for journey funds. Whitewater rafting, good. Raft. Now a lot of you, how many of you know what the raft acronym stands for? Maybe, okay. Four of you, that's good. It's all right. Raft. You got some blanks, so we'll do a little bit of fill in the blank. The R stands for, first of all, responsible. Raft is one of those things that for years we've taught this in leadership, and we teach it in serving. You'll see it in some servant leadership stuff. I believe if you go back to the old Sun Life stuff with Dan Spader, you'll find this. But the first thing you find is responsible. Are you being responsible with the things that God has given to you? Are you being responsible with the things that other people have given to you? Let me ask you this question. If you were out raking leaves today, or raking straw, or raking anything, did you leave the rake or did you pick it up and bring it back? Were you responsible with that rake? You see what I'm saying? Are you responsible? You see, you have the capacity to be responsible. That means you can do it. It's not impossible for you to do it. And some of you come from homes where you were taught, be responsible. Okay? Some of you come from homes where you're not taught that. I have three kids back home. McKenna is our oldest. She's 15 years old. Guys, none of you get any ideas. Okay? I'm just telling you, I can make a phone call and you can disappear. She's my little baby girl. No, I'm messing with you. If you love Jesus, we'll tell her. In about 30 years. About 30 years, okay? No, McKenna, she picks stuff up. She's smart. And so when she was younger, I started teaching her the RAFT acronym and responsible. She is in a class in the public school there in the town where we live, and there's a guy teaching her welding, teaching other students welding. So McKenna is learning how to be a welder, and she's actually a very good welder. It's kind of funny, you know, she's got blonde hair, and she loves singing and doing like musicals and stuff like that. She's a really good welder. It's just, it's kind of uncanny. And so she actually, because she is responsible, she was giving a field job today. There were people who paid her to go and weld some posts for her, because they needed somebody who could weld, and it's kind of, you know, the people there in the town where we live, the old welders, they're like, I can't even get down on my knees anymore, I can't. And so they get her, because she's like, I can go down on my knees and do all this stuff. And they're like, so she can do the welding. So she is doing the welding there. But she is asked to do this because they know that she is responsible. She gets babysitting jobs. Why? Because she's responsible. One of our other children is not picking up the whole idea of being responsible. It's a whole other thing. The next line is respectful. Oh man, this is the line that I really don't like to teach. I don't like to teach it because I have a hard time being respectful of people. Just being honest and transparent with who I am as a person. I struggle with being respectful. There is still something inside of me that says, I want to be a little king. I want to be the man. And so for some reason, an issue that I struggle with in my life is being disrespectful to people. And it is not okay. And so I just need to tell you that, because I don't want to stand up here and let you think that I've got this whole math thing figured out. Because I don't. I'm working on it. I think it's very, very important. I think as followers of Christ, we must implement these things into our lives. But being respectful. Let me ask you a question. So let's just throw this out there. Anyone give an answer? What is a way you can be respectful in your lives?
You can be respectful by honoring your parents or your teachers.
Yeah.
And you can do things for them.
Yeah. helping them out? Mom and dad? Now, you know what? You're not serious about respecting mom and dad, are you?
She is.
Yeah, you're right. That's tough. That's tough, especially if you come from a bad home. That's tough. What's another way?
Respect your siblings.
Respect your siblings? No, you take that back. That's just not right. I gotta take that home to my kids. I'm taking that home to my kids. Respect your siblings. Hey, I got siblings. I got four older siblings. My brother's 11 years older than I am, and then our three older sisters are older than him. It's still hard for me to respect them. Yeah, that's tough. How many of you got siblings? Brothers and sisters, yeah. That's tough to respect them, right? One more example, respect. Elder.
Friends.
Yeah. Friends. What do you mean?
Respecting.
Give me an example of how you mean respecting your friends.
Well, like if they tell you not to tell somebody something, like don't go around and tell everybody.
Yeah, you gotta stop the verbal diarrhea sometimes. You ever had somebody do that to you? You say something to them in confidence and they just spray it all around? That's not good. Do you understand what it means to be respectful of your friends? Do you understand that when you are respectful, here, if I am respectful, Reg is my friend, if I am respectful of him, then when he and I have conversations, we can have honest conversations. Because he knows he can trust me. He knows that I'm not going to be putting stuff out on Facebook. He knows that I'm going to keep it in confidence. And then he knows he can come back to me another time and I can go to him. I'll just tell you, in the years that I've known Reg, I can be very, very honest and transparent with him. Because I know he cares about me. I know he's respectful. I know he's responsible. Let's look at the next one. A stands for available. Available. Are you available? Now this weekend is super cool. You guys are being available to come here to Camp CUMCITO and serve. This is good stuff. But let me ask you a question. Are you available on Wednesday nights when youth group is done? And everyone is going home, and there's stuff that needs to be cleaned up. Did you notice that a lot of times at that point, your availability goes, you're like, I'm not available. No, I got to go meet with President Trump. He and I are going bowling. Cosmic bowling. I can't back you, Reg. Love you, Lord. Love you, Jesus. Love you, Reg. See you, bro. No, I used to be a youth pastor. I understand. I understand having to back in the church. It's a bummer. Our youth group would get out. I think it was some other time, around 9 o'clock. There were times that I would be there at the church until 11. And I had a full-time job working in construction at the same time, so I had to get up at 6 o'clock the next morning. And I lived clear. So this is when we lived in Kansas City. My youth group was in Olathe, off 153rd and Ridgeview, roughly. And we lived clear up in Kansas City, Kansas. And so I get down 11 o'clock, and I'm like, and you got to get in the car, go home, get up the next morning, go to work. Are you available to serve this youth ministry? Because you're sure available to serve here at Camp CUMCITO this weekend. Just think about this. F. Anyone know what F stands for here? Huh? Faithful, yeah. Faithful. Are you faithful? Let me pick on my good friend Reg again. He's faithful. My watch, I got a friend that's he's a chief engineer for Garmin, and so he gets me like prototype watches and stuff. Man, this thing, it's got all the bells and whistles. It's a great mountaineering watch, okay? It'll do this, it'll do that, blah, blah, blah. But it runs on a rechargeable battery. And so to some extent, this watch is not that faithful. My good friend Reg is faithful. When this thing runs out, I can call him.
Reg? Yo, yo, bud.
Hey, man, what time is it? My watch is dead. Okay? Hey, He's a servant. He'd tell me. Actually, he'd probably say,
"Hey, bud."
He's faithful. Guys, he's faithful. Are you that kind of a friend? Are you that kind of a child to your parents? Are you faithful to them? Are you faithful to the cross of Christ? When you go to school, when you're in the locker room, guys, I've been there. I know for the guys what this is like. You go into the locker room and the other dudes, they start saying stuff. And I'll tell you, at that point, it's really easy to start, like, you know, kind of turn your back on the whole Jesus thing because you don't want them to make fun of you because there's about 10 of them and only one of you. Are you faithful then to Jesus? Are you faithful to grow in this student ministry that is trying to invest in you? Are you faithful to the adult leaders who are giving of their time for you? The last one is teachable. T stands for teachable.
Yay.
Teachable. Are you teachable? Here's the difference between somebody who is teachable and somebody who is not. For those of you who are teachable, you will leave this weekend and you will say, you know what? That makes sense. And I need to do that. And then the other hand, or the other type of person is, that made sense. Oh well, I'll just go do whatever I want. C.S. Lewis, I love this. He said, there are two kinds of people in this world. You know, you can always break stuff down. Like, I think one of my favorite ones, there's three kinds of people in this world, those who can do math and those who can't. That's mine. But C.S. Lewis said, some of you didn't get that, so you fall in that category as well. C.S. Lewis said this, there are two kinds of people in this world. Those who say to God, thy will be done. And those to whom God says, all right, have it your way. You catch the difference? There are those who look to God, they say, God, thy will be done. I don't care what's going on around me. I don't care about the locker room. I don't care what people think of me. Thy will be done. Your will be done, God. And then there's the other kind of people, and they're like, God, I'll do it however I want. And he says, all right, have it your way. You see, guys, you're going to leave Camp CUMCITO on Monday, and you're going to go home, and the difference is going to be if you are going to apply this stuff in your life and start applying it. Look, you're not going to be perfect. I get that. I worked with student ministry for 20 years, or over 20 years. I don't know. It's starting to get fuzzy now. But I'll just tell you, I have seen through those years students that will implement and apply these things to their lives, and then I see the students who don't. Pretty easy. If you notice on the side, there's like a little post-it note tape on there. These are the character qualities of a servant. These: raft, responsible, respectful, available, faithful, and teachable. Look, don't call yourself a servant if you're just saying, I don't care about this stuff. Don't even bother calling yourself a servant. Matter of fact, tell people the truth. Just say you're coming to Camp CUMCITO because you want to pat on the back or you want to get away from mom and dad or something like that. But if you're not willing to implement these things in your everyday life, look, I get the fact that we tend to be selfish. I am. My wife tells me, I thank God for my wife because she's honest with me. And she'll say, Steve, right now you're being a selfish jerk. Steve, if you're going to sit there and say you're walking with Jesus, you've got to put your nose in the Bible and live it. Don't just say you're walking with Jesus. Live walking with Jesus. And guys, I'm telling you the same thing. If Jesus isn't everything to you, then he's nothing to you. And sure, there's those days where you're going to be selfish. And Jesus is saying, come back to me, child. Come back to me. And so we do. A lot of times we come to him, we're all beat up and scarred from the stupid junk we get into in this life. I know. I got a lot of scars. And I'm not talking about just scars on the skin. I'm talking about scars of the heart. And you come back to him and he says, my child, I have so much more for you. Some of the things that servants do, look down below here, about a third of the way, or two-thirds of the way down the page. They serve until it's over. Really over. Oh, no. Audrey, I saw you mouth that one there. You know, you heard that. Like twice, I'm sure. Serve until it's over. Really over. Somebody tell me what that means.
Farmhouse that I
cleaning my room.
And so then I would come back downstairs and I was like, all right, it's all done again. I had to go busting out the door, jump on my bike. I was like, you know, I got to go pedaling away as quick as I can before the wrath of Khan shows up. Well, guess what? I get home later. My sweet little old mom. Steve, did you clean your room the way I told you to? Mom? It's like, don't even call me mom. Right? You guys know what I'm talking about. I knew what needed to be done, and I knew what her expectations were. But I was just like, I shoved everything in the closet, kind of trying to keep, and then get that door. You know what I'm talking, some of you know what I'm talking about. Some of you are neat freaks, and it's just weird. But then the rest of you, you know, you're like me, you're like trying to keep, and then you're trying to figure out how to not slam your foot and your hand in the door while you're holding up everything. And then right about then a Lego rolls out. You notice the things that need to be done in student ministry, in the fuel and journey. You're going to notice things that need to be done. Guys, you know where the chairs go. You know where the couches go. You know where the vacuum cleaner is. Use it. Help to put stuff away. Because what that does for Reg, what that does for the adult volunteers, what that will do for other people, what that will do for your life, is huge. Remember, I was telling you that my daughter McKenna got asked to do a field welding job. They could have farmed that out to any welder. But they chose to take a 15-year-old girl that's more interested in doing dance and musical theater because she is responsible, respectful, available, faithful, and teachable. Not all the time. Not all the time. She's not perfect. Nobody is. Look at this last quote down here. Love is primarily giving. It's an action that leads to a feeling, not a feeling first. Love is primarily giving. Let me tell you about Jerry. Jerry's my friend. Jerry is like a father to me. Jerry's 76 years old. I talked to him earlier today, and he told me it was okay if I tell you this stuff. Jerry founded an outlaw motorcycle club in the state of Washington called the Hombres. They are now a brother club with the Banditos Motorcycle Club. The Banditos is basically the largest, most dangerous motorcycle club in the world, because they have chapters in other parts of the world, in other countries. And the Hombres have chapters that are primarily up in the Northwest. An outlaw motorcycle club, a lot of people call them motorcycle gangs. They don't like to be called gangs or clubs. They're called one percenters. There are a lot of people call them the bad guys. And Jerry founded the outlaw club, the Hombres. I think he founded it about 25 years ago, 27 years ago, something like that. Jerry can use the words murder, prison, and Jesus in the same sentence. And not crack at a smile, just telling you the honest truth. Jerry has burned down buildings. Jerry has had people put to death. Jerry has done stuff that's not good. Jerry has tattoos on himself also. Jerry has steel blue eyes that when he's serious, he stares right through you. Jerry can tell you about how a motorcycle club murdered his brother. No tear comes to his eyes. Just like stone when he talks about stuff like that. But when you talk to Jerry and he starts telling you about Jesus and what Jesus has done for him, there's like a light that comes on. I was talking to him earlier, he's been really sick. And when you're 76 years old and you got the problems that he does, when you get sick, it may be the end. So I called him up this afternoon, I said, Jerry, man, buddy, how you doing? I said, Steve, I'm doing a little bit better. You know, he's kind of hoarse, and he's not sounding super great. He said, I'm doing better, but I got to tell you that they put me on hospice today. Hospice, some of you know what that is. That means that they are expecting you to die, and so they are just trying to make you comfortable until that happens. Now, it doesn't mean you are going to die, because only God knows when that's going to happen. But doctors, nurses think that he's going to die, because he's just in bad shape. I said, man, Jerry, that's crazy. I said, so what does that mean? He said, well, I've been talking to a lot of people in the club. I've been talking to a lot of my brothers. They said, we call them brothers in the club. He said, I've been telling them about Jesus. You need to understand, these are men who have murdered. These are men who have run drugs. These are men who the ATF and the FBI have been after. These are men who have done horrible, horrible things. And he's calling them up and saying, hey, they've got me on a hospice. They think I'm going to be dying soon. And so I just want to tell you about this guy named Jesus. And because of who he is, and because in the whole realm of motorcycle clubs, people respect him. He was telling me about the time that Hell's Angels tried to have him killed. So they sent two guys who shot him. You know, they shot him with guns. He's got the wounds, and he lived. He said, and he told me, he said, Steve, I must be tough, because not even the Hell's Angels can kill me. They tried. And then he told me about another club that tried to have him killed. And he lived through that. And yet here he is. He's saying it's about Jesus. And I said, Jerry, this is what I told him earlier today. I was out by the little slide over here by the cafeteria. Jerry, if you could come to tonight when I'm speaking and you could talk to this group of incredible young people, what would you tell them? I said, Jerry, you lived a lot of life. What would you say to them? He said, Steve, I've lived it all. I've had money. I've had women. I've had fame. I've had power. He said, I've had it all. And he said, none of it matters. None of it matters. He said, tell them that at their age now, the only thing that matters is Jesus and walking with him every day. That's the only thing that matters to Jerry. This is a man who he has had people put guns to his head. And he said, shoot, people are already trying to kill me. You can try too. This is the guy who almost, he has his wife, Deb, they went down to Pueblo, Colorado, which maybe you guys don't know this. Pueblo has a lot of gangs, Bloods and Crips going on there. And there were some guys in a gang, and they were making comments to his wife as she was walking up to a store, and Jerry got out of their truck and started walking towards him. And he said, when they saw him, they split. But he told me, he said, Steve, if they would have said one more word to her, I was going to tell them something, and then I was going to, know this before he was a Christian, but he said, I was going to make a phone call, and he said, we would have had two motorcycle clubs in Pueblo, and they would have forever changed the history of Pueblo, Colorado. This man has power on just a phone call. All he has to do is make one phone call, and then all sorts of motorcycles with bad people show up. But he doesn't care about any of that. All he cares about now is Jesus Christ. And he told me, he said, Steve, I don't care if I die because I'm going to see my Lord. That's unbelievable. And he wants you to know the same Lord. That's what matters to him. Guys, I want to close up here. But there's some stuff for you to be thinking about. There's stuff from Raft. There's stuff from being a servant, what it truly means to be a servant. There's stuff from being what's important in your life. Like, is Jesus important? For some of you here tonight, Jesus isn't anything to you. He's just like a name. That's it. He doesn't want to be just a name. He wants to give you not just life, but abundant, full life. He offers that to you. Again, Jerry was telling me, he said, see, tell them that Jesus will give them more than what they ever expect. Jerry, what about serving? If you could tell him something about serving, he said, oh, please, tell them to serve one another, to serve adults around them, and to serve other people. He said, I lived for myself. I lived for myself for 73 years. He said, none of it matters. The only thing that matters now is Jesus. And he said, now I want to help other people so they will see Jesus. That's it. So here's the deal. Jake's gonna come back up. He's gonna do another song. And what we're gonna do is, we've got adults here in the room. You guys need to talk to one of the adults. Just go back, find an adult, sit with them, talk with them. If you gotta share some stuff, do that. Get it off your chest, talk with them, have them pray with you. And then when Jake is done, I'll come back up here and we're gonna do something else that's pretty cool, okay?